Good morning, Unity of Roanoke Valley. Let's start out today by blessing the Christ candle with that great affirmation. There's only one presence and one power in our lives and in the universe, God the good, omnipotent. Today we're going to be starting a six-part series on this wonderful book by Reverend Ellen Davenport called The Five Principles, Five Basic Principles of Unity. We'll have more to say about that, but particularly that first principle, which we'll be talking about today, which centered what we just said around the Christ candle. There's only one presence, one power, God, the good, omnipotent. A lot of times it's expressed, God is absolute good, everywhere present. God is absolute good, everywhere present. And it can be mumble words. We can say it and not really feel it. But particularly when a crisis hits, because a lot of times we'll feel when we hit a crisis or a bump in the road, we'll think, well, yeah, God is in this, is in that, but when it comes to my love life or it comes to my finances or dealing with the IRS, God's nowhere in sight. But when we can realize that God is everywhere, that there is no spot where God is not, and are able to bring that connection with the divine and realize that that divine spark is inside of us, and see it if we're facing a challenge in our love life or a challenge in our finances. If we can realize that truly that we're walking through this with our higher power, a higher power that loves us, is for us, that we were born blessed and remain blessed, when we can feel that way, then the situation starts looking really different. That great Unity teacher, Eric Butterworth, said that our first job is not to set things right. Our first job is not to set things right. Our first job is to see things right. And when we can see that, one presence and one power, and know that in our heart of hearts, then even when we are going through, you know, the valley of the shadow of death or whatever, we can feel that joy. We can feel that peace that Paul said passes all understanding. And as I say, we can know that real joy. And interestingly, today's daily word is joy. The affirmation is, I carry joy in my heart. My many happy experiences and memories may lead me to feel joyful, but I know they are not the source of my joy. One of my divine gifts, joy, is part of my spiritual identity, as close to me as the next breath. Joy wells up and spills over within me, and when I bring my awareness to my spiritual nature and to my oneness with all good and all light, things begin to flow. It is an attitude I hold in mind and a feeling in my heart. The happiness I feel in life depends on my allowing my inner wellspring of joy to come forth. I nurture my joy by maintaining a regular prayer life and practice that enhances my awareness of God, and by making time for the things that make me happiest. I go into the world grateful for the joy that resides within me, my gift to share generously. And from Isaiah we read, for you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. Today's daily word is joy. And during those times where, you know, we may not be feeling that joy, one of the best ways of recentering and getting that joy is to go into prayer and meditation. Call your prayers into us at 540-562-2200, 540-562-2200. We have a wonderful spiritual care team here, and representing that spiritual care team and to lead us in prayers, Chris Cameron. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Reverend Rick. What a wonderful word to take to prayer, joy. Let's center into our heart space for a moment. that feel that sensation of a deep, abiding joy that is within us. And as we feel that joy, we feel a sense of love, of healing, of peace within us. We send out that same sense of love and joy and healing and peace to each one of those whose name may be in this prayer box, to each one that we may be holding in our own minds and hearts who may be facing a challenge. And we see that ever-present, ever-loving spirit that resides within each one of us. And we surround one another, we surround our community, we surround the world with that deep sense of love and peace and healing. And we are grateful. And so it is. Amen.
Amen. And now, music will lead us into a time of meditation. Regeneration. Jesus said, "It is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." And he also said, "I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly." And so, even if we face a challenge, maybe even because of that challenge, we feel that renewed sense of power, love, majesty, awesomeness, and faith. And it is in this spirit and in this connection that we go into the silence. Dear Spirit, thank you for this time of rebirth, this time of resurrection. Help us to step forth boldly to be of love and service in this world. And for this, and so much more. We say thank you and amen and amen. Thank you, Chris, and thank you to our AV wizards. Thank you, Skip. Thank you, Cody. Thank you, Bill, and thank you, Samantha. And I say this every week because it's true every week. Skip is putting up really wonderful stuff at the end of the service. The music is really good if he can get it through YouTube, which is sometimes a challenge. It's funny as a hoot, and it's really spiritually spot on, so don't turn the machines off at the end of the service. Well, I came to Unity of Roanoke Valley, left Tulsa, and came here. It was June of 2020, right in the middle of the pandemic. We were doing these YouTube services. We also remember we're doing parking lot services outside. We would broadcast the service into people's FM car radios. It was sort of like a drive-in movie theater. We were doing everything like a drive-in movie theater, except we weren't serving popcorn, because of the pandemic. And I instituted I made very few changes, just two in particular. But I think these changes are really, really important. If you've been a longtime person at Unity of Roanoke Valley, think for a moment what you think those two changes might be. Jeopardy, da-da-da-da, time's up. The first change was, really, I instituted the beginning that we would say that the Christ candle was blessed, but to specifically say that unity affirmation, there's only one presence and one power in the universe and in our lives, God the good, omnipotent, which is really the first of unity's five basic principles. God is absolute good, everywhere present. A key reason for doing this is because, if you're not centered on that, then the rest of the service doesn't really make too much sense. If we're living in a world where, there's God on one shoulder and the devil equally, on the other shoulder, if God is not absolute, or quite frankly, if this is just, a random event or sort of a meaningless random event, then a lot of the unity principles and a lot of other spiritual walks really don't make too much sense. Paul, the Apostle Paul said, you know, talked about this and said, you know, if this is not the case, then we're really a bunch of idiots. I mean, we should eat, drink, and be merry because, you know, carpe diem. No, you know, tomorrow's going to happen and it's going to be nothingness afterwards. If the reality is, you know, life stinks, you have to pay taxes, and then you die, if that's the reality, then a lot of the other principles that we're talking about in terms of love and service and everything else really does not make that much sense. But when we can center in on and realize that's not the deal. I mean, Albert Einstein, I think, put it so well. He said, you know, one of the basic questions we face is this universe that we're in, is it sort of like a hostile environment that doesn't really concern, you know, is concerned about us at all? Or is this a loving and supportive universe which is here to help nurture us? And Einstein said he favored and he believed the latter. Then these principles of love and service and taking the time for prayer and meditation and all that, then that stuff really starts to make sense. And the rest of the service makes sense. But if you don't buy into the first one, you know, really, this, you know, you could say change the channel because the Jerry Springer show is much more interesting, you know, is much more interesting than this. The other change which I put in, the second change, is when we say the prayer for protection. The light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, the presence of God watches over us wherever we are. A lot of times people said, and all is well. I added in the words, and it wasn't, I'll tell how I got this, you know, because God, you know, wherever we are, God is. I added in, because God is, all is well. And there's a real important to that, and it ties very much back to saying that first basic principle. Because quite frankly, if you're not saying, you know, because God is, all is well, then, you know, the criticisms that, you know, a lot of times are leveled at New Thought and at Unity, it's a bunch of happy babble, start to ring a little true. Let me tell a story about how that prayer for protection got started. It was World War II. It was World War II, and that Unity's poet laureate, James Dillett Freeman, who actually wrote the prayer for protection, James Dillett Freeman was asked to do something. They came to him and said, you know, it's World War II, and a lot of times people now say the 23rd Psalm, you know, when they're in danger. Yea, though I walk through the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And so they turned to James and they said, you know, picture yourself, you're a housewife in London and Nazi bombs are landing all over the place. Saying, yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I mean, you know, you might want to come up with something a little more comforting or something, or a soldier, you know, facing in a charge and facing, you know, tanks or whatever. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. So, Jim, could you come up with something else? And Jim looked up and he said, in other words, you're saying I'm supposed to improve upon the 23rd Psalm. I'm supposed to do something better than the 23rd. What an assignment. And his first draft, what he came up with was, Christ light directs you. Christ love enfolds you. Christ might protects you. Christ peace upholds you. And that was the original. And then he thought, well, I can, he started improving and said, the light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. And the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is. That was the end of it. And God is. It was only after that people started adding in, and all is well. And all is well. Really? All is well? I mean, critics could look up and say, all is well? The Ukraine is getting pounded and nothing, you know, it's not their fault they're getting pounded and atrocities and war crimes are being committed in the Ukraine and all is well. Inflation, my God, if we don't look, we'll do something, inflation's going to be double digit. We could have hyperinflation here. All is well. The pandemic, my God, the pandemic, what planet are you on? All is well. And they have a point. In this material realm, there are a lot of situations which might not seem just or right or fair or you know, healthy or good. But when you can then say, because God is, all is well. Realizing that, you know, if this part of the story where we are does not seem right or fair, that's because this is not the end of the story. This is not the end of the story. Or as Paul put it so well and told the Romans in Romans 8:28, all things work together for good for those who know and love God. When you can start to see it from that perspective, when you can start to see things from that perspective and realize that so often positive evolutionary change comes not out of when things are going super well, but come out of when there is a serious crisis, then you can say, because God is, all is well. As Myrtle Fillmore, the co-founder of the Unity Movement, so often taught us, look beyond appearances. Look beyond appearances. In the 1880s, the doctors told Myrtle Fillmore that she had an incurable illness and there was no more medical science could do for her and she was probably going to die soon. And all is well. It was then that Myrtle had that great spiritual awakening and insight and could look beyond appearances and know that her essential nature was that Christ within, our hope of glory, and that her nature was health. And she could turn to that and was able to recover from what doctors had thought was going to kill her in a few months. And she lived many, many years later. And she, from that, said, it is so important to look beyond those appearances. We're starting what's going to be a six-week series on this wonderful book by Reverend Ellen Davenport, a Unity minister, called The Five Principles, which go back and look at those key five principles. And today we're going to be centering on the first principle. Last week, we looked at the backstory behind how these five principles got created. And again, if you missed it, the great marvels of technology, go to our website. You can click on or go to YouTube. You can go to our website and just click it on and watch from last week. As I said, a very simple way of thinking about the first principle is simply that God is absolute good, everywhere present. God is absolute good, everywhere present. Ellen writes, and I think this is a wonderful way of looking at it. She said, if I had one wish for the world, it would be that every adult re-examine his or her view of God at least once per decade. God may not change, but people do. And we outgrow our old concepts of the divine. I would say more, I mean, quite frankly, if I could amend that sentence, I have one wish, and it wouldn't be that people do this every year. I would say I would wish they do it every other year. Or maybe as an annual event. Truly, sit down with a notebook and start writing. What do you really believe about God? And start writing that. Ellen writes. She says, you know, what happens to a lot of people is they face a crisis and they have a very childish kind of notion about God, from the past and all that. And Ellen writes, instead of changing their thinking, however, too many people simply throw away their belief in a higher power, and with it, the divine guidance, wisdom, and comfort that could enrich their lives. We so often come to, and I know it happened to me, with the death of my father when I was 17 years old, had very childish notions about the divine. My father dies. My reaction is, you can take this religion and just chuck it. And that was the end of that. Fortunately, later on in my life, I was exposed to unity and was able to see that perhaps there are deeper concepts of what a higher power, of what God could and is, than, you know, my childhood notions. Ellen writes, principle one, that first basic principle, God is absolute good everywhere present. She writes, principle one maintains we are one with God, not separate, not being watched, but immersed in the divine. As the Apostle Paul told the Athenians, we live and move and have our being in God and in oneness. God lives and moves and has expression in us. A God of oneness, writes Ellen, is an immanent God inside us, and also a transcendent God that is within us and all around us, within us and all around us. What we call the word for it is not pantheism, but panentheism. PanEntheism, panentheism. God is both immanent and transcendent, that we are in the divine, almost like we are part of a drop of water being part of the ocean. But that ocean so much transcends in many ways that dot that we are. Ellen writes, the Buddhist sutras envisioned a net stretching in all directions. The Hopis spoke of Spider Mother God, who spun the great web connecting all things. The ancient Chinese, it was the Tao, or the flowing of the universe. The hymn of creation from the Hindu Rig Vedas speaks of an absolute called Brahman and describes it as ultimate, eternal, and beyond all description. This is the ground of all being, or infinite reality. We hear the names of God, writes Ellen, Holy Spirit, the universe, the way, Father, Mother, Creator, Divine, one mind, source, energy, first cause. And then she writes, and thanks to Star Wars, the Force. It has also been named Allah, Buddha nature, Christ, Kali, Krishna, all concepts of the divine. And she adds, physicist Max Planck, the originator of quantum theory, spoke of conscious and intelligent mind. Astronaut Edgar Mitchell called it nature's mind. In scientific terms, it is the field of pure potential, an energy that undergirds all creation. It is all that is. It is all that is. I think it is so important for us. Ellen says every 10 years, I would say at least every other year, to really sit down and ask ourselves, what do we really believe about God? What do we really believe about the divine? And then once we write it, to really start to ask ourselves, what do we really believe about God beyond our press release? Beyond our press release about God, because I think so often what we'll be writing is a press release about God. And yet, there's something which is much more important. When we are in a crisis, when we face a difficulty, do we really act in a way which is which has congruity with that press release? Or are we acting in a way where it's totally, as it were, totally different? In Alcoholics Anonymous, there's a wonderful book called The 12 Steps and the 12 Traditions. It was written by Bill Wilson, one of the co-founders of AA. And he talks about the person who is full of God and full of jinn. Full of God and full of jinn. And this, he says, seems to be such a mystery to everybody. He seems to believe so much in God. And yet he's still an active alcoholic. What's going on? And Bill says to a lot of people in the outside world, it's a mystery. He said, to us, it's not a mystery, because it's not just the quantity of faith. It deals very much with the quality of faith. In this case, it would be a person who has a wonderful press release about God, but in terms of what they actually believe and how they are living in their heart of hearts, there's a great difference. Let me tell a story. Back in the 1970s and 80s, there was a book by a psychiatrist, M. Scott Peck, called The Road Less Traveled. It was a widely, widely read book, a wonderful, wonderful book. And in it, he talks about one of his patients. His name was Ted. And Ted said to, you know, Scott Peck said, I'm an atheist, a very strident atheist. That's quite frankly what I am and all that. And during one of the sessions, M. Scott Peck turned to Ted and said, you know, Ted, I accept what you were saying, that you're an atheist and all that. But if you had a tape and you could replay our sessions, and if you watch them, I think you would see something very different from that press release. You would see a guy talking about almost as if there was malevolent gods, malevolent deities. And all you had to do, you know, if you just poured the right libation to this malevolent deity, maybe you could soothe the savage god. Or, you know, my God, it's a god which if you step on one crack, this god is going to shoot down lightning and really punish you. Well, Ted was, you know, there's a saying, you know, the truth may set you free, but probably the first time you hear it, it's really going to upset you big time. Ted was upset big time. What do you mean about that? And went away from the session in a huff and then really started to think about it. He said, you know what? I really have been living my life, although I say I'm an atheist, I've been living my life as if there really is this malevolent deity. There's some malevolent force, and I've been trying to soothe it. I've been trying to placate it, and I'm really fearful if I do one little thing wrong, it's going to put thunderbolts on me. He went back and saw Scott and said, you know, you're right. You're really right. Things started to change. And then one day, Ted came in and saw Scott Peck, and he said, you know, I'd like you not to call me Ted anymore. I'd like you to call me Theodore, my full name, Theodore. And Scott said, okay. He said, but you know what Theodore means? He said, yes, I do. Theodore means lover of God, lover of God. And this patient went on to enter the seminary and become a minister. I would suggest, you know, with this principle, this first principle, God is absolute good, everywhere present. I would suggest that we do a few things when we're really assessing. First, step down and get a cheap notebook, write down, what do we honestly believe about God? What do we honestly believe about the divine? And then we look at sort of how we are living, like Ted. Is there a congruity or is there a real inconsistency? Like I say I believe in a loving higher power that has my back covered, and yet, oh my God, in this situation? Ram Dass one time said, if you think you're so spiritually enlightened, spend a week with your parents. Spend a week with your parents and find out how spiritually enlightened you really are. We do that. We honestly write down what we believe and how we think we honestly are acting. And second, we look at that for the differences. Where are those key incongruities between what we say about God and how we are actually living our lives? And then third, if we want to bring this more into alignment, if we want to bring this more into alignment, probably our egos are not powerful enough to do this, really. Our egos will fail us every time and time again, to get this type of alignment. We go to prayer. we go to prayer and say, God, this is what I would really want and what I, in my heart of hearts, what I like to believe. And yet, I see that in certain areas of my life, the faith isn't there. The zeal isn't there. I mean, I just am so different, and there's this incongruity. And just to pray, I cannot change this of myself. As Jesus one time said, in and of myself, I can do nothing. What he meant was in and of his ego. Even Jesus realized in and of his ego, he can do nothing. But to realize that's not the end of the game. There is something within us all which is beyond our egos, beyond our personas, which can start to make that alignment between our press release and how we truly are living and believing. And then we may be amazed. May not happen for some of us instantaneously, but we may be amazed to start seeing changes happen in our lives. And to start to see things where, my God, that would have sent me down the tubes with fear. And it hasn't. It hasn't paralyzed me. I'm starting to walk the walk much more than just talking the talk. Let me tell another true story about where I think to really does demonstrate the importance of this first principle. And it's about Amy Grant. And Skip is now putting up a picture of Amy Grant. Amy Grant's that, she's a wonderful singer in many genres, a Christian singer, great in country, and also in pop music, a Grammy Award winner many, many times over. And Amy, she grew up, I mean, she talks about her grandmother and her parents, but particularly a lot of times she talks about her grandma, about her spiritual faith coming from her grandma. She started singing in churches, was seen as really talented and dynamite. Next thing you know, she's recording. She's so successful and everything else like that. She's married to Vince Gill, the country singer. Fabulous career. Lives in Nashville, wonderful house in Nashville, kids, everything else, grandkids. And so she's doing concerts, and these concerts are really strange. She's just turned 60. And she said, I started to feel, and she has to belt out 25 songs or more at a concert. It's strenuous. And she said, I felt like I was pedaling a bicycle with the wheels were deflated or something, and it was really hard. She goes in and sees a cardiologist, and the cardiologist said, my God, Amy, you have certain cardiological birth defects, certain veins and arteries which were supposed to go in this ventricle are going into that ventricle. We need to do some open heart surgery, and we need to do it pretty soon. Before the end of the year. So Amy said, all right, I have this tour which I have to do, but then after that, I'll do the open heart surgery and all that. Doctor says, okay. But then it turns out to be the pandemic, so no concert tour. The doctor says, you really need to do it now, and we can get you in. So there's Amy, really living in the compound in Nashville, not going out too much, and walking, feeling, looking around at the garden and everything else like that, and with this wonderful spiritual past. And she says, you know, I really believe in this, you know, despite what I say I believe about God, I really have a sense of God as transcendent, up there, looking down, judging. And she said, going into open heart surgery, I'm scared. And I need more than a transcendent God. I need that immanent God. And you know what? I don't really have it. I don't really have that sense of the immanent. I have the transcendent, but I don't have the immanent inside of me. And that's what I need. She realized that there was an incongruity between her press release and what she really felt. And going into open heart surgery, she needed that imminent God who felt it was right there with her, going through it, back covered, inside of her. As Paul said, living, moving, having our being in. And she realized that, you know, her ego probably wasn't going to be able to create it before that sense, that feeling. She just really prayed and said, I need this. I need this sense to face this open heart surgery. And I can't do it alone. Help. And she started to sense, not immediately, but she really started to sense this imminent higher power, this imminent spark of the divine, which she hadn't felt in years. She was able to take that into open heart surgery, which was successful, which was successful. And she said, you know, I'm glad the ventricles are, you know, and the arteries are where they're supposed to be. But what I'm really, really glad about is that wasn't the only thing that got fixed up from that open heart surgery. More importantly, I started again to develop a sense of God as imminent. Christ in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Jesus talked about building on sinking sand. Said a lot of people build on sinking sand. Crisis comes, whatever, and it's sinking sand. The house goes down in a jiffy. But then he talked about people who build on a rock. People who build on a rock. Build on something which is firm. And when we have that firmness in our lives, then we can face things that we thought we could never face before. We can be of love and service to other people. We can be the grown-ups in the room. We can be sanity. We can face calamity with serenity. And that first principle of God being absolute good, everywhere present, is that rock. Is that rock that we can build on. Thank you, and God bless. Now we step into a time of offerings, of tithes, of gifts. And I really want to say thank you to all of you out there in YouTube land, out on the internet. Your support of this ministry during the pandemic has been so crucial and so important. And I want to thank so many of you for doing this. We face so many wonderful opportunities. We are getting new families in here. People, a lot of times, are first time they're exposed to the Unity message has been online. But as Jim Rosemurgy, that great Unity teacher, said, it takes, even mystics have to pay bills. And so do we. And so we would ask you, please, to send your contributions to several ways of doing it. One, you can do it online by going to unityofroanokevalley.org. That's all one word. Unityofroanokevalley.org. That is our website. You'll see that there are ways which you can click on and give. The other is that snail mail, it's slower these days, but it still is working. You can send donations to Unity of Roanoke Valley, 3300 Green Ridge Road, Roanoke, Virginia, 24019. That's Unity of Roanoke Valley, 3300 Green Ridge Road, Roanoke, Virginia, 24019. And I know many people who come here, they love to get affirmations. Your computers now don't have C drives anymore. I'd put the affirmation through the C drive and you could pull it out. But I picked one which let it stand for all of us, and it's a good one. I step in the direction of my dreams and angels are guarding my path. I step in the direction of my dreams and angels are guiding my path. Let's say that great, wonderful blessing. Divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I am open to receive, and I am grateful. A few quick announcements. If you're not getting our electronic newsletter, free electronic newsletter comes out on Thursdays, please go to our website, unityofroanokevalley.org. That's unityofroanokevalley.org. Click on, you'll see it's so easy to get the free newsletter sent to you. It tells about things that we are doing here, classes, yoga. Some of it is done here. Some of it is done online. You can do it at the comfort of your house. Also, we are so blessed to have a beautiful, beautiful spiritual oasis here. 26 wonderful sacred acres, rose gardens, fountains, nature trails, our labyrinth. It's open 24/7. Come on down. It's a great place to take a deep breath and truly talking about immanent gods, feeling that one with the one. So we'd love you to come down and visit us. Also, we have our Sunday service live here. It is every Sunday at 11 a.m. Come on down sometime. We would love to see you. Lastly, if you are really enjoying these services, I would ask you please to click on like, or to their ways of sharing it, both either sharing it on Facebook, sharing it on other forms of social media, or to send it to friends. There may be some friend that you have that you think that these messages could really help. So I would ask you please to click that like, send that share, pass it on Facebook, if it is something which you feel could really appeal or help other people. And with that, we have a great way of closing. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is. And because God is, all is well. And Spirit says, build on that rock. Build on that rock, because it is a firm and solid foundation. And all the people said, Amen.
Sometimes we make it harder than it is. Take a perfect night and fill it up with words we don't mean. Dark side's best unseen, and we wonder why we're feeling this way. Sometimes I wonder if we really feel the same, why we can be of hearts. That's when we must start believing in the one thing that has gotten us this far. I'm